As I said, really, we had a lot of uncertainty this week about the stimulus, about the COVID coming back on both sides of the Atlantic, and about the economy overall. Why does the market, the equity market, keep going up? This is 3 weeks in a row now.
You know, David, it's interesting because just in the last few days, the equity market rate of growth has kind of slowed down. I think the markets are watching the stimulus plan, as you said, the uncertainties that have increased. The other side of it, though, is I think there is more and more agreement in the market that it is possible that Vice President Biden may be getting elected. And people are starting to digest the fact that taxes may come later, but fiscal policy could come earlier. And that could result in serious growth. And if there is also more equitable kinds of packages that the government does put out compared to right now when we have no agreement on a stimulus plan, that could also be very helpful for growth. So markets are starting to take some of those theories into consideration as they have gone up a little bit this week and last week.
So, Bob, what do you think about it? I mean, is it sort of a hope that there's an all blue, if I can call it that, government? Or what are the markets paying attention to? What should they be paying attention to?
Well, one of the things we see in the equity markets is, you know, they call it the Dow because it's a certain number of companies that they're following and the S&P 500. And a lot of the small businesses, I mean, David, the truth is that 400,000 small businesses have closed since the pandemic. I don't think any of them would be publicly listed or in any of those indices. So in the economy, what we're seeing is we're clearly in the third stage. I mean, the first stage was closing the economy and it was kind of the left side of the V. Now the right side of the V was equally sharp coming back up, but it stopped well below the level at which the economy had been. And it's really a question now of, is it gonna be even there? Is it gonna continue to go up or is it gonna potentially go down? And that's why there's so much focus right now on the need for more stimulus.
Well, at the same time, Bob, what do you make of things like the retail sales numbers came in at the end of the week and they were actually surprisingly strong, and also housing seems to be doing well. There are some indications, aren't there, that the economy actually is doing pretty well?
Yeah, you know, consumer spending is really, really strong, and so people look at that. But if you tear that apart, spending on goods is up strongly. Since February, since before the pandemic, consumer spending on goods is up actually 5%. It's higher than it was in February, where services are about 60% of the level that they were pre-pandemic. Now, here's the rub. Two-thirds of the economy is in services, and 85% of the employment in our economy is in services. So when we look at those consumer spending numbers, we have to separate what's on goods versus what's on services, and the real impact on small businesses and employment in the services sector. I mean, we kind of all know it, but the numbers are very stark.
So, Sonny, Bob Swing makes a very good point about this divergence between services and goods, which I think is different from what we've seen before, isn't it?
Absolutely. I think Bob is absolutely right. And this is something which is a global phenomenon, by the way. Obviously, services sector in this country has increased its share hugely. But even if you look at parts of Europe and in particular in Asia, the share of services have also increased on a relative basis. But that certainly is a really important factor. I would say also when we look at these numbers, they hide so much, as Bob said about retail. We look at the unemployment numbers. They're hiding the fact that the total number of people who actually are staying unemployed is getting larger and larger. The number of people who are unemployed in the lower income brackets is going up, while in the higher brackets, it's not going up as much. So that disparity that we're seeing overall in the economy is happening also inside those employment numbers.
Sonny, one of the things that struck me this week was we had the IMF meetings, and we heard earlier from both Federal Reserve Governor Jay Powell and also Madame Lagarde from the European Central Bank that we need more fiscal service. But we actually heard from the IMF. We heard Kristalina Georgieva today say, don't worry about the deficit. I don't remember the last time that I heard the IMF say, don't worry about a fiscal deficit.
I was going to say, Bob Diamond and I have gone to many World Bank meetings, and I worked at the World Bank, so I ran a lot of those meetings. And it was really interesting because it's always been about fiscal austerity, right?
Exactly.
And this is a huge, huge change in direction that the head of the IMF has declared. And also, by the way, a lot of economists are talking about. But what I would like to also highlight is that who can borrow, actually. She has said we should, those who can borrow should borrow and get their economies to be on a different growth path. And I actually quite agree with that. The problem is those countries that cannot borrow. Obviously, the IMF has some money to give out to those. But if you think about the scale of the countries that are in need and cannot borrow, that is huge.
Bob, what about that? What about the companies that can't borrow? Because one of the things that Kristalina Georgieva talked about was some debt relief.
Yes. And by the way...
For Bob.
I mean, there's no question. I think I saw an interview with Larry Fink, who talked about being bearish on the emerging economies today. I think when you look at the reaction of the currencies and the unemployment levels, it's a function of how difficult it is for them to get the fiscal stimulus, 100%.
At the same time, Sonny, is this an alarm bell for us that the IMF itself is asking for more lending? That suggests something about the global economy that's not very strong.
Well, I think the IMF has realized that having these very, very strict austerity programs when countries were down actually did more damage. So they have learned the lesson, which is a good thing. I think the question is that if you borrow, eventually you have to pay it back. And these countries, if they borrow in U.S. dollars and their own currencies depreciate relative to the U.S. dollars, will have to even pay, you know, larger amounts. And so they are going to be in more trouble down the line unless they get on a growth path that gets them out, which is sort of the way the IMF is talking right now. And the chief economist of the IMF is also talking that way.
Bob, just to pull this all together, let's go back to Sonny's original point. Should we be encouraged by the fact that it may well be, not certain, may be that we get a President Biden, maybe even a Democratic Senate, and they certainly will borrow and they will spend a lot of money?
I think business is a lot more comfortable with the prospect of a Biden presidency. Now, you know it'll be an increase in corporate taxes. He said that. But remember, corporate taxes went from 35% to 21%, and Vice President Biden's talking about 28%. There'll clearly be an increase in capital gains tax. But on the other hand, we can expect more stimulus in a Biden administration than I think we would otherwise. And I'm going to tell you, I think trade relations around the world, which have been truculent, to steal a phrase from another one of your guests today, Larry Summers, and I think that will change. And I think the prospects for a boost to the economy with better relations and better trade, there's some positives here.